Hi everyone, it's time for my fifth installment of my Public Education and the Hidden Curriculum series. Today we're going to be talking about intellectual dependency. That is the fifth step in the Hidden Curriculum. Now, in my last installment, I talked about emotional dependency, and there is a lot in common between emotional dependency and intellectual dependency. Now, I've got to tell you that intellectual dependency, this one really, really touched a nerve with me because this is the one that I see having the most effect on learning for children. Now, usually I will only read to you from the book if it's a couple paragraphs long, and this one is a little bit longer, but bear with me. I think that it is certainly worth reading to you in case you've never read it, because again, no one said it like John Taylor Gatto said it. So I'm going to read what he had to say from the eyes of a teacher, and then I'm going to leave my commentary, which I have quite a bit on. Intellectual dependency. The fifth lesson I teach is intellectual dependency. Good students wait for a teacher to tell them what to do. This is the most important lesson of them all. We must wait for other people, better trained than ourselves, to make the meanings of our lives. The expert makes all the important choices. Only I, the teacher, can determine what my kids must study. Or rather, only the people who pay me can make those decisions, which I then enforce. If I'm told that evolution is a fact instead of a theory, I transmit that as ordered, punishing deviants who resist what I have been told to tell them to think. This power to control what children will think lets me separate successful students from failures very easily. Successful children do the thinking I assign them with a minimum of resistance and a decent show of enthusiasm. Of the millions of things to value to study, I decide what few we have time for. Actually, though, this is decided by my faceless employers. The choices are theirs. Why should I argue? Curiosity has no important place in my work, only conformity. Bad kids fight this, of course, even though they lack the concepts to know what they are fighting, struggling to make decisions for themselves about what they will learn and when they will learn it. How can we allow that and survive as school teachers? Fortunately, there are tested procedures to break the will of those who resist. It is more difficult, naturally, if the kids have respectable parents who come to their aid, but that happens less and less in spite of the bad reputation of schools. No middle-class parent I have ever met actually believe that their kid's school is one of the bad ones. Not one single parent in many years of teaching. That's amazing and probably the best testimony to what happens to families when mother and father have been well-schooled themselves, learning the seven lessons. Good people wait for an expert to tell them what to do. It is hardly an exaggeration to say that our entire economy depends upon this lesson being learned. Think of what might fall apart if children weren't trained to be dependent. The social services could hardly survive. They would vanish, I think, into the recent historical limbo out of which they arose. Counselors and therapists would look on in horror as the supply of psychic invalids vanished. Commercial entertainment of all sorts, including television, would wither as people learned again how to make their own fun. Restaurants, the prepared food industry, and a whole host of other assorted food services would be drastically downsized if people returned to making their own meals rather than depending on strangers to plant, pick, chop, and cook for them. Much of modern law, medicine, and engineering would go too, as well as the clothing business and school teaching, unless a guaranteed supply of helpless people continued to pour out of our schools each year. Don't be too quick to vote for radical school reform if you want to continue getting a paycheck. We've built a way of life that depends on people doing what they're told, because they don't know how to tell themselves what to do. It's one of the biggest lessons I teach. So, yes, I'm sure that one probably hit you as much as it hit me, because it just touches on so many different things, and it really is the foundation of so many problems that we have in society today, the least of which is the fact that no one knows how to do anything for themselves anymore. And I don't know how many times I've talked about this issue, but it is so important because our country, America, was built on the hard work of people who were self-sustaining. They knew how to take care of themselves. They knew how to get things done. This whole hidden curriculum of intellectual dependency, starting, yes, from when those schools were first implemented in like the 1860s or 1870. That is when the whole spirit of independence started to wear out. Because, yes, we have grown too used to being told what to do by authority figures. Think about the repercussions that has had on society. We are a completely consumer-driven society. When people don't have the money to purchase the things that they need, they have no other means other than charity of acquiring them, because we have lost those basic fundamental skills of taking care of ourselves. Those skills were taken out of us, or taken away from us, because the school system does not want us to have those skills. They want us to be dependent on what experts, on what authority figures tell us what is worth doing, what is worth learning about, because that is what keeps our economy going. That is what keeps our current way of life going. And if you think about this in terms of children, how many times have you seen children before they started school? They're constantly exploring. Little scientists. They're so creative. They can find the neatest things to do with objects that you would never have any idea you could possibly create something out of it, like a paperclip and a string. Give it to a three-year-old, she'll figure out what to do with it. But very, very quickly, you will notice if you have a child who goes to school, or if you have observed kids who go from not being in school to being in school, is that at first, maybe even that first year, kids are still probably enthusiastic. And if you think about it, a lot of times kindergarten does have more play, and sometimes it is still only half day, although it is starting to be more full day now. So a lot of times even kindergartners are starting to get hit with this even earlier. But what does end up happening once a child has been in school for a year or two is that they no longer are curious. They don't care about exploring anymore. They don't ask as many questions as they used to. And as parents, you know, a lot of times we will always joke with people about, oh, my kids are constantly asking questions. But as frustrating as it can be sometimes, especially if you're busy, those questions are the sign of a curious mind. They are the sign of a mind that is alive, a mind that wants to know things, a mind that has not been broken down. So what happens is these kids go to school. They start being told every day what it is specifically that they have to learn about by their teachers. They very often, their questions are batted down because there's just not time for those sorts of things. There are certain things that a teacher has to present to the kids, and it doesn't really matter what their interests are. It doesn't matter what their rabbit trail questions are about. If it does not fit within the confines of that curriculum, it likely will not be touched on, especially in today's classroom of around 30 students, sometimes even more than that. So after these kids have all this time of the teacher constantly just telling them what it is that they have to learn, the child's passion for learning, it dies. Or at least if it doesn't die, it kind of hibernates for a while, with the hopes that someday it will be set free again. But that is what they do. They no longer know how to learn. They just start to develop this attitude of, well, if this is important for me to learn about, even though I think this is neat, if this is important, I'll probably cover it in school. Or I think we'll cover this subject in school, so I'm not going to worry about it because my teacher tells me what I'm supposed to do. And, you know, very often that's what happens. But, you know, another thing that a lot of kids are thinking is, they don't care. They no longer even want to learn about things anymore, because not only are they constantly being told what it is that they are supposed to think, what it is that they are supposed to learn about, that they just lose that love for inquiry. that kids have. It's just work to them. Learning is just work. Learning isn't fun. Learning isn't something that you do just because you want to do it. Learning is something that people tell you what to do. Learning is something that people do to you. They tell you what to do. And I see that happening so often in so many kids. I saw it happening in my own kids when they were in school. And I'm so glad that we have been homeschooling for such a long amount of time, because I have seen their passions come back. And I've also seen in my children who have never been to school or who were in school for a very short amount of time, I can see the difference in their drive, in their creativity, between those who spent a longer amount of time in school. Even my kids who have been, now we've been homeschooling consistently now for 8 years. We've been homeschooling for 10 years. We homeschooled for 2 years, went back to school for 2 years, and then now homeschooled straight through now for 8. Even though it's been 8 years, those kids who were in school the longest still struggle at times with motivation, because they are still stuck on that mentality of, I need someone to tell me what to do. I need someone to tell me what I should think. I need someone to tell me how I'm supposed to get things done. And the sad thing about it is that this goes on through us into adulthood, especially if you look at this whole issue of the expert. How often are we hung up on what experts think? What is the expert opinion? And this is very often a stumbling block for people who want to homeschool. They do not believe that they can educate their own children because they are not experts. Whether it is a mainstream child or a child with special needs, they completely have no confidence in themselves. They have no confidence in their ability to research things and learn how to do things that they desperately want to do, because we have all been brainwashed into this idea that only experts are worth listening to and only experts are worth telling other people what to do. And so, you know, when you go back to the whole school issue, of course you have the good kids and the bad kids. The good kids, they're those kids that really take well to having the teacher constantly tell them what to do. They listen, they put forth good effort, they sometimes will show enthusiasm. You know, you see kids in school, when a teacher asks a question, you'll have the kids, ooh, 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 I remember that from when I was in school. Yes, there are kids like that. Those are the kids who fit well into this conforming mold of school. But then there are the bad kids. Now, very often, we parents of those children would not consider them to be the bad kids. Teachers do. Not necessarily teachers, but the education system itself considers these kids to be the bad kids. Why? Not because they're criminals, not because they're juvenile delinquents, because they are disrupting the teaching that the teachers have been told that they have to put forth. Because these kids, they're not quiet about something if they disagree. They're not quiet about it if they don't understand why something even needs to be taught. Why is it important that this is being taught? How is this going to help me in real life? These are the kids who will question things that don't make sense. And they will have no trouble at all questioning those things. They think independently. And yes, they challenge the teacher quite a bit, but that is because these are the children who have not yet had their wills broken by this intellectual dependency facet of schooling. These are the independent kids. These are the creative kids. Not necessarily creative as in more creative than the good kids, but these are the kids who are not afraid to show it. What happens to these kids? What happens to these bad kids? These are the kids who are often taken out of mainstream and put in special classes. You know, the whole stigma of special classes. As homeschooling parents, we understand that learning happens in a variety of ways, and it doesn't mean that one child is more intelligent than another just because they learn in different ways. That is not the image that is put forth in school. If a child does not conform to the structure that schools have set up for them, yes, they are treated as less than. They are treated as less intelligent. They are treated as less worthy of listening to. And very often, yes, even teachers will try to encourage their students to not listen to those kids. Don't pay attention to those kids. Don't do what they do. Look where they're at. Yes, it happens. I said this in one of my other videos before. When I was in fourth grade, I had a boy in my class. He was one of those kids. He was one of those bad kids because he asked questions, because he wasn't afraid to speak up when things didn't make sense. He wasn't afraid to speak up pretty much about anything. And do you know what my teacher did? Now I've got to point out, my teacher, he was a very nice man. He was a Sunday school teacher. But do you know what he did? He brought in a pacifier to school and he made the little boy put it in his mouth. Fourth grade. It was to humiliate him. It was to make him feel less than. It was to make him conform because he was disrupting the rest of the day. And, you know, how sad is that? And the thing is that as Mr. Gatto said in the reading that I left with you today, if there are parents who are really involved in school and are really paying attention to what's going on, it is much harder to push those kids aside and stigmatize them because their parents will speak up for them. But the problem is that less and less and less and less parents will do that because, as he said, he has never met a middle-class parent who thinks that their child's school is one of the bad ones. And that is, you know, that is something that is rampant all over the place. When you try to inform people about the dangers of public education, when you try to inform them about the true purposes of it, they don't want to hear it because their kids, they go to a good school. They always, you know, that always comes up. Our schools are different. Our schools are good. So those parents, if they truly believe that their kids go to a good school, they're not going to speak up because they are going to believe that the school has their child's best interest at heart. Because again, why does the parent believe that? It is another effect of that intellectual dependency that has been ground into us from the minute that we set foot into a public learning institution, possibly a private learning institution. I can't speak on that. I have never been in a private school. I can speak about public schools, and I know this to be true. That is why so many parents have this mentality of, my kids go to a good school, because they have truly just fallen prey to the notion that teachers and principals and school authority figures, they are the experts. We're nothing. We're sheep. That's all that we are. And I think that a lot of people, they wouldn't even notice that whole aspect of the sheep part. And I've got to say that I actually just borrowed that from Vodi Bakum because, yeah, he, if you've ever watched Children of Caesar, he said it exactly right. They want us to be slaves. They want us to be their sheep. And very often we are. Because their hidden curriculum, their system of pushing conformity has done such a good job that it's not just about the children anymore. It's covered generations. And that's all that I have for you today. I look forward to going over next month installment of the Public Education and the Hidden Curriculum series. And the next topic that we are actually going to be covering is provisional self-esteem. So let's see what we have to unpack from that. Anyway, I just want to thank you so much for your support. I really, really appreciate it. I love having people to talk to about this. I love having people who have the same passion about this sort of thing that I do. And again, thank you so much. Have a great, great day.